some of them will join later. So registered participants record suggests that we have participants from 7 countries: Algeria, Indonesia, Libya, India, Nepal, Vietnam, as well as United States of America. I want to take this opportunity to thank senior management of Ames University for their full support to implement this Bi-Safety and Bi-Security Month at Ames University. I also want to thank Ames University's Institutional Bi-Safety Committee members for their support in implementing Bi-Safety and Bi-Security Month. Today's speaker is Dr. Parshuraman. I want to thank Dr. Parshuraman for accepting the invitation and becoming a part of this Bi-Safety and Bi-Security Month. I also want to thank especially Dr. Richa Sood. She is going to moderate today's session. And it's early morning in India. So thank you, Dr. Richa. So I just want to little bit tell about Dr. Richa. Dr. Richa is currently serving as a principal scientist as well as assistant biosafety officer who is in charge of animal biocontainment facility at Indian Council of Agriculture Research. The institute is National Institute for High Security Animal Diseases. So the center is located in Bhopal in India. This one is a premier institute of India for research on exotic as well as emerging pathogens of animals. Her field of specialization is veterinary medicine, and her master as well as PhD is in veterinary medicine. And she has more than 6 awards and honors at national and international level. She has she's very, very active in promoting biosafety and biosecurity by conducting different types of programs. She's having a membership of national and international different societies. Those are working very hard for promoting biosafety and biosecurity. Just to name one, she's also a founder member executive council of Society for Biosafety India, and she's an executive council member of Asia Pacific Biosafety Association. So in addition to that one, she's a member of different societies. As far as publication is concerned, she has published more than 50 peer-reviewed papers in national and international journals. She has published 15 book chapters as well as manuals, and she's conducting various workshops on biosafety and biosecurity. She has also presented in a number of conferences. So thank you, Dr. Richa, for accepting our invitation and becoming a part of our Biosafety and Biosecurity Month. It's a pleasure to have you. So last but not least, I want to especially thank our biotechnology students. Those are helping me and the Institutional Biosafety Committee to put in the things in place to implement the activities of Biosafety and Biosecurity Month. So I want to thank especially the students of biotechnology program, at Ames. So once again, thank you, all of you. Without further ado, please Kanchana, lead the way. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Subhash. I would like to apologize for the technical issue. We kindly request all the participants, please mute your microphone. Thank you. Now I would like to invite Dr. Richa, our today's moderator, to introduce our speaker and begin the session. Dr. Richa, please.
A very, very good morning to one and all. I have 7 countries which have participated in it, which is really very impressive. And kudos to you, Dr. Bhore, for that. Thank you so much for such a wonderful introduction. It feels very good to be connected with you so early in the morning. It is around 10 a.m. at Malaysia, but here in India, we have just begun a beautiful day at 7:30 a.m. and the winter is just peeking in. It is my pleasure today to welcome you all and moderate this talk. In this age, when the world is threatened with emerging and zoonotic diseases and pandemics, very dangerous for shadows, it is only relevant that we take up such training programs to keep ourselves abreast with the latest in disease diagnosis. Not only this, the concept in biosafety and biosecurity involved with the present disease and pandemic scenario have now become a very, very serious matter. I appreciate the step taken by the team AIIMS under the leadership of Dr. Bhore and his all the supporters to generate awareness on the nuances of biosafety and biosecurity. Yes, this is the fourth, as Dr. Bhore mentioned, fourth lecture in the series where AIIMS University is observing October 2020 as month of biosafety and biosecurity in association with APSA, International American Biological Safety Association. Well, we are aware that animal usage is indispensable as animal models serve as good predictors of human responses, help in understanding the normality as well as the disease cause so that new drugs, vaccines, or procedures to prevent or treat diseases can be identified. Animal research is very vital to requires critical thought, judgment, and analysis. Using animals in research is a privilege granted to the research community, with the expectation that such use will provide either significant new knowledge or lead to improvement in human or animal well-being. Animal experimentation, in comparison to laboratory research settings, create several additional hazards. Now, in order to understand that better, so that a well thought and a sensible decision can be taken in animal experimentation, and dangerous things could be envisaged, we have a renowned speaker, Dr. Parshuraman, is going to talk today. Dr. Parshuraman, he is M.Pharm and PhD in a unit head of pharmacology and associate professor at Faculty of Pharmacy, AIIMS University. He also is an editor-in-chief of Journal of Young Pharmacists and an associate editor of Journal of Pharmacology and Pharmacotherapeutics. Dr. S. Parshuraman has over about 75 scientific papers in national and international peer-reviewed journals. He is nationally recognized expert in branches of experimental pharmacology research, including in vitro screening methods, pharmacokinetics, and toxicology research. He served. Dr. Parshuraman holds a bachelor and master's degree of pharmacy from Tamil Nadu, India. Dr. Parshuraman is going to deliver talk on biosafety considerations for use of animals in research on human health hazards. So, Dr. Parshuraman, the floor is all yours for the talk.
Thank you, madam, for your brief introduction. Good morning, participant, and good morning, chairman and moderator. Madam is given brief introduction about myself. So directly, I would like to go for the topic. Today's topic is actually really interesting, but I don't know. But having limited interest on society and the scientific communities. Before going to the topic, I would like to thank AIIMS University for organizing Biosafety and Biosecurity Month to making awareness about biosafety process. AIIMS University organizing series of talk in under celebration of Biosafety Month. In that today's program, I am going to discuss about biosafety consideration in animal experimentation. Just a moment, I will share my PowerPoint. So please, anyone can, please let me know my screen is shareable.
Yes, sir, you can share the screen.
Already I shared my screen.
But we are not able to view it, sir.
Oh, can't able to. Otherwise, just a moment.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just it will be two screens are sharing. I can stop sharing from my desktop. Now clear?
Yes, sir. We can view the slides.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, your mic is muted, sir. Your mic is muted. We cannot hear you, sir. Sir, we cannot hear you.
Excuse me, sir.
No, please.
Yeah, clear. It's clear now. Better.
Yeah.
Go ahead, sir.
Okay, thank you. Sorry for technical issues. Okay, in today's presentation, we are going to discuss about biosafety consideration for use of animals in research. Before going to first, we'll see difference between animal research and animal testing, and what is the purpose of doing animal experimentation, and what are the problem encountering with animal experimentation related to the pathogens, and we'll see what are the preventive measures can be taken. So there is difference between animal research and animal testing. Usually people are having the misunderstanding between animal research and animal testing. So animal research is a universal term, and also it will be very common terminology. In animal research, normally the researchers, they will study about animal behavior and their eating pattern and their lifestyle and their physiology, anatomy and genetics and their disease profiling, everything it will cover. Animal research, it will be basically starts from monitoring of animal behavior and animal characteristics and genotyping and phenotyping studies, everything. But animal testing is totally different. Animal testing normally used to test drugs on animals. So that will be called as animal testing. So animal testing is nothing but testing the drugs for its safety and the pharmacological efficacy using suitable animal models is called as animal testing. Animal testing is a part of animal research, but animal research is not part of animal testing. So we have to be clear with animal testing is part of animal research, but animal research is not part of animal testing. So that's why we are using animal for the research. So the animals, especially rodents and non-human primates, they are having very similar anatomical structure and physiological behavior compared to human beings. So humans, we are having two lungs, animals also two lungs. So we are having one heart, the rodent also having one heart. We are having one liver, animal also having one liver. We are having two kidneys, the rat and the mice. And intestinal pattern also similar, and the bladder and the excretion system almost similar. Only there is difference between BMR only, basal metabolic rate. But otherwise it will be genetically, we are almost 90 to 98% similar. So that only we are using animal for the drug discovery process. Moreover, we can now, in many places, the government agencies highlighting that we can go for alternative models or we can go for the in vitro testing. Yes, we can go with in vitro testing or alternative models, but there is a problem. In vitro testing, we are testing drugs or we are studying the characteristic and pharmacological profile of a drug by using the in vitro model on particular organ or particular cells. But we are not taking drug for one particular organ. If you are having headache, you are taking drug through mouth only. If you are having the leg pain, you are taking drug through mouth only. So that when I take the drug, it will travel through the body. So that we want to know the safety of the drug when human they are taking. So that only the animal test, drug research are very, very essential. So physiologically, we are both similar, but we cannot able to use for use human being for the drug testing purposes. So that only animal animal experiments are very, very essential. Okay, what are the
unmute, sir. Hello, sir. Sir, I think you are connected on two devices. One device you can mute.
Sorry, someone unmuting my system.
No, there are two devices you are connected with. So one device you can mute. So it will be all right. One device you can unmute. One device should be muted, sir. That's why it's making noise. Okay. Yeah. One device you can mute, sir. Yeah, thank you.
Now
it's clear, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. So animals we are using for different purposes. So that in academic institute is very, very less. Around 1% only we are using in academic institution. But thing, mainly the animals are used for drug research and toxicological testing and vaccine research. And also cancer research. Okay, so... So globally, around 80 millions of animals are used for the scientific purposes. That was statistics on 2015. In United States itself, around 25 million vertebrates are used for drug research and testing, drug testing and academic purposes. But thing is actually major question. So this many number of animals you are using for the various research purposes, but what happens end of the study? Because many times the animals are euthanized means killed during or after the experimentation, but we are not having any accurate data on animal euthanization. So that this is major concern area, since we are using around 80 million animals per year, but we are not having any accurate data, on euthanization. So that this is one of the major area, because this animal, what are the animal we are killing, that is actually one of the medium for pathogen growth. So that we have to really concentrate on the what will happen to the animals at the end of the experimentation. That is one of the major area. And also, whatever animal you are using in laboratory, those are the animals carriers. These animals used to carry the pathogens. That's why in many of the protocols now, the investigators are requested to use specific pathogen-free strains, SPF, specific pathogen-free animals. Why? Because most of the animals used to carry the pathogens. So those pathogens may not produce any symptoms or any diseases to the animals. When the host, when human being or it will be those who are working in animal house, when they are being in the particular environment, they may have chances of acquire disease from these vectors. So this normally the animals will carry pathogens like virus, bacteria, fungi and parasites. Normally the mice and rat used to have pneumonia virus, that is actually single standard RNA virus. Transmission occur via aerosol through breathing. transmission via aerosol. Same like one of the most important pathogen which mice or rat used to have Sandy virus. The Sandy virus is actually RNA virus. This also get transmitted through aerosol, but the symptoms in rat or mice is asymptomatic. This particular pathogen present in mice or rat, it won't show any symptoms. But thing when we are getting this particular virus, we may have some consequences. The antigenicity of this Sandy virus almost similar to the human para influenza virus 1. So antigenicity is almost similar. What are the symptoms we are observing with human para influenza virus 1? The similar symptoms observed with infection due to the Sandy virus. So one more cytomegalovirus, this is actually DNA virus. This also get transmitted via saliva, animal saliva. So mouse parvovirus type 1, this orphan parvovirus, this will be get transmitted via urine, fecal matter or other respiratory routes. These are the most common thing. Apart from that, mice used to carry retrovirus, thymic virus, retrovirus type 3, mouse memory tumor virus, lactase dehydrogenase evolving virus, adenovirus, and hantavirus. Regarding hantavirus, we'll discuss later. These are the viruses commonly commonly present in mice or rat, and also bacteria like cilia associated respiratory bacilli CAR. Actually, this is actually gram negative pathogen. This will be transmitted via respiratory route. Klebsiella and pneumonia, gram negative bacterium. This also get transmitted through fecal oral or aerosol transmission. Helicobacter, this is commonly present in mice, not in rat, guinea pig, and hamster. Because these rat, guinea pig, hamsters are susceptible to infection with Helicobacter virus, Helicobacter bacterium. So this Helicobacter from mice will be get transmitted via fecal oral contact or other forms. Citrobacter via radium, this is actually gram negative pathogen. This will be get transmitted via food and bedding contamination. Apart from that, pathogens such as Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Salmonella, Streptococcus, Cyanobacterium, these are the common bacteria usually laboratory mice used to carry from outside to our culture areas. So, and also the mice and rat used to carry mycoplasmosis, then Streptococcus pneumonia. These are the two bacteria. Also, the mice and rat used to bring fungi, pneumocytosis, carniae. This will be transmitted via infective cyst. So whatever cyst, it will be hung and it will be, sometimes it will travel through hair also. The parasites, the mice used to bring parasites to the animal house. So when any animals you are bringing to the animal house, animal must have to go for quarantine for minimum 7 to 14 days to prevent cross infections. And also this in animal house, we used to have a lot of breeds of animal. When any new animal come to the our colony, so that may kill our existing colonies if they are having any of these pathogens. So that we have to be careful with the animals when we are bringing to the animal house. And also we have to, many times where we are working with animals, that is questionable. So before going to the working area, okay. So now we are having a common problem, COVID. Whether COVID will be get transmitted through rat or mice, exactly, correct answer is not clear. But as per the scientific evidence, no. Why? Because this rat and mice, we are not talking about chimpanzees and monkeys, only rat and mice. This rat and mice, the news from National Geography, they are saying that no evidence that that they can become infected with SARS-CoV-2 virus. Why? The answer is already we have answer for that. Why? Because this mice and rat not having the binding protein. The mice is lacked with the binding protein, name is ACE2, angiotensin converting enzyme 2. Because the coronavirus, that is SARS-CoV-2, it will be largely affecting angiotensin converting enzyme 2 protein. That protein is enormous in smooth muscles of human being, but in mice and rat, this protein is not up to that much. So that the mice and rat, it won't bring this coronavirus or SARS-CoV, COVID-2 to the our working areas. So that one way we are safe. But the thing is, other animal models, non-human primates, rhesus monkey and cyanomegalo monkeys, they are prone to have coronavirus infections. And most of the animal model used for screening the drugs against coronavirus, these animal models are used. Rhesus monkey and cyanomegalo monkeys are used for screening the anti-coronavirus effect. Apart from that, hamsters also may susceptible to have SARS-CoV-2 infections, but most commonly parrot and non-human primates are used for screening COVID-19, any drug for COVID-19. So that mice and the rat is very safe to bring to animal also. So that those who are working on mice and rat, they need not to be worried at this point of time. Because these mice and rat not having the binding SARS-CoV-2 binding protein, that is angiotensin converting enzyme 2. So that we don't need to worry much bother about these. But thing is, actually, we have to really bother about other pathogens, such as already listed, few of the bacteria, fungus, and parasites. We have to really bother about all those things. Okay. Now, mostly the researchers, where they are doing animal experiment, animals or regular laboratories, both are wrong. Because many times when you are observing, because I am not talking about drug industries or pharmaceutical companies. Okay, so I am talking about academic institution. Normally, the students, where they are doing animal experimentation, that is questionable. Region to region, place to place, it will be varies. Usually, animal house meant for to make animals to provide healthy living environment. Regular laboratories meant for to perform experimentation. Regular experimentation, not for animal experimentation. So usually animal house is not meant to carry out any animal studies. Okay, where we can do? Because animal studies should be conducted at least BSL, ABSL level 1. Animal biosafety level 1. If the study not having any pathogenic risk, the study should be conducted under animal biosafety level 1. If normally the regulatory agencies recommending this study should be muted. The study should be conducted in animal biosafety level 2. Animal biosafety level 2. Okay. So animal biosafety levels are designed to protect personnel from exposure to a potentially infectious material. So biosafety is very important. And the quarantine facilities are very, very essential to prevent the spread of the infection from animals to animals. So both the things we have to really take care. So usually animal laboratories are classified as a four different types: animal biosafety level 1, animal biosafety level 2, animal biosafety level 3, animal biosafety level 4. What are those? Because so far we are much aware about biosafety level BSL 1, BSL 2, BSL 3, BSL 4. But we are not much aware about ABSL level 1. So both are similar, but the ABSL level 1, ABSL level 2, ABSL 3, ABSL 4 meant for the animal experimentation. Okay, what are the experimentation can be done under different biosafety levels? ABSL level 1, if any the experiment not having any defined or known not having any known pathogenic risk, then those experiment can be done under ABSL 1. In case the study having moderate risk of pathogenic infection and known, it will be the water stains. So water stains, okay. So ABSL allowed to. In case the water investigational drugs are, it will be pathogens using in animal experimentation, having to have mild to moderate risk, those studies should be conducted in ABSL 2. In case the study is involving with dangerous item, aerosol transmission, serious and potentially lethal infections, like tuberculosis, studies on tuberculosis, those studies should be carried out in ABSL 3. In case it will be study involving with high risk agent, like some of the potentially carcinogenic agent, radioactive materials, those things, those kind of studies should be done in ABSL 4. So usually the study should be conducted in either ABSL 1, BSL 2, ABSL 3 or ABSL 4. Normally the regulatory agencies are recommending all the studies should be conducted under ABSL 2 minimum. If the study protocol not having any potential risk of spread of disease or any ominous, so those kind of studies should be conducted under the level 2, ABSL level 2. So okay, so it will be normally non-pathogenic strains with the STI, for example, E. coli. Those studies can be done with BSL level 2. Streptococcus aureus, BSL level, ABSL 2. Then microbacterium studies is microbacterium, ABSL 3. Ebola-like diseases, ABSL level 4. Because ABSL, those pathogenic having high risk of disease spreading, those should be done under animal biosafety level 4. Okay. So now we've seen about where can be done animal experimentation. Okay, now we'll discuss about who has risk, how the risk will be assessed, how this risk can be managed. Actually, who has risk? Animals. Animals having risk. Why? Because the one animal got infected, automatically the pathogen will be get transmitted from one animal to one animal through aerosols. It will be through air, or it will be bedding material, or it will be through water, or whatever things we are using in animal house. Okay, so animals having high risk, animal caretakers, really they are having risk, animal caretakers. Why? Because almost they are spending 6 to 8 hours in animal house. So they are having high risk of getting pathogenic infections. Technicians, those who are working in animal house, and who do serve the animals, and who clean the rooms, animal house rooms, and finally the researchers, those who are spending large amount of time with animals, those who are having the high risk to get pathogenic infection from animals. So that the biohazard is recommending, this will be appropriate layout for, okay, dressing pattern for those who are doing or entering an animal house. Shoe cover, it will be long lab coat. Sometimes the students will come with a small lab coat and with the off sleeves, that is not recommended. Full sleeve and long lab coat, shoe cover. Okay, it will be head cover, face mask, and gloves. So PPEs are very, very essential to protect ourselves. PPEs are, because these PPEs will prevent, it will be direct contact, direct skin contact, direct eye contact, direct inhalation of air, ingestion, and aerosol and punctures and other animal materials. So always those are entering in animal house, those who are doing work in animal house, they are recommended to have PPEs to prevent pathogenic transmissions. And also, usually the animal experiment, animal experiment mainly involving with infecting pathogens, genocytics, they are having high risk. Why? Because we are taking the culture. For example, if you are doing the studies with wound healing activity with Pseudomonas aeruginosa, after making the wound, the Pseudomonas will be spreaded on this animal skin. That time, what can be happen? The investigators or the lab workers, they are having more high chance to acquire Pseudomonas infections. So those kind of things are having highly risky, because some of the animal models are involved with pathogens, like it will be induction of the wound, and also it will be anti-diarrheal studies. These kind of the models having high risk of spreading the disease. Okay. And the zoonotic infections sometimes results of asymptomatic infections. So symptomatic means there won't be any problem. We can go and get cure ourselves by treating or consulting with a physician. But asymptomatic infections, we become carrier. Through us, other people will get infected with the zoonotic infections. Okay. So that the acquired infection associated with animal activities, almost 171 over infection between 1979 and 2005, in that majority of infection caused by antivirus. Antivirus is recently, 3 months before also one incident, there is an antivirus incident, the person was died after getting admitted in hospital. Because this antivirus is most common in rat and mice, but they may not have any symptoms. That antivirus, it will be get spread over there in lab, everything. Those who are entering in lab, or those who are cleaning, or those people having the high chance to get infected with antivirus. But one important thing, this antivirus won't transmit it from human to human, only rodent to human being only. So that way we can save. Because if it will be again transmitting from human to human, that will be one of the major issues. But thing is, almost this antivirus caused major incidents with laboratory workers. So this virus will cause minimum chills, fever, and muscle ache. But later on, it will produce dry cough, headache, nausea, vomiting, and shortness of the breath. Sometimes it will make induce life-threatening complications. Okay. So almost 12 viruses are, it will be identified. These 12 viruses are dead listed virus on earth. 12 viruses are dead listed viruses, in that Marburg virus, Ebola virus, rabies virus, HIV virus, smallpox virus, antivirus, influenza virus, dengue virus, retrovirus, SARS-CoV, SARS-CoV-2. This one is very latest one, SARS-CoV-2 in 2019. MERS-CoV. So in that Marburg virus, Ebola virus, antivirus. So having high chances of spreading through animals, especially rat and mice. Marburg virus and Ebola and antivirus. These are actually antivirus transmitted through dropping of infected mice. The mortality rate is around 12%. Out of 100, 12 will die. It will be, the mortality rate is higher than SARS-CoV-2. The SARS-CoV-2 having mortality rate of 4%, but antivirus is 12%. When compared to antivirus, the Marburg virus, the mortality rate is around 80%. If 100 will get infected, in that 80 will die. So that these viruses, antivirus, Ebola virus, and Marburg virus, having high risk of transmission through laboratory animals, especially through mice and rat and chimpanzees, monkeys. So that these are the 12 dead listed virus, in that 3 are getting transmitted through animals. So when you're working with animals, you have to be careful. So that only recent protocol, recent amendment stating, okay. So the whenever possible, the researchers are recommended to use specific pathogen-free animals for their research. Okay. So, and also most common thing is the allergies, allergen present in the animal bedding and animal air and animal urine may cause a lot of discomfort to the researchers, and it will produce asthmatic reaction to the those who are entering in animal house. Okay. So compared to earlier incidents, laboratory incidents, and found that the workers working in animal house and the researchers working in animal house having high chances of getting allergic reaction and allergic symptoms. And also he found that increased risk of allergy and allergic symptoms with duration of exposure to the animals, What is the remedy now? Incidents might be reduced by limiting hours per week of exposure to the laboratory animals. Usually, this will be practiced in radiology lab. If radiology lab, those who are working in radiology lab, they have radiation batch. If the radiation batch is indicated that they are having more amount of, or they are having the, they are exposed with more amount of radiation, so that time, label will indicate, so that time the workers or the physicians, they will go for the 1 month break or 2 month break to minimize the exposure to the radiation. But animal house, we are not having any indication like that. But the incident, the animal house incident, minimum allergic reaction can be reduced by limiting hours per week of exposure to with animal laboratory animals. Those ways we can reduce the risk. Okay. How we can manage the risk? Okay. The major problem with facilities. facilities is a major problem, because many countries having standard rules, some of the third world countries and second world countries not having appropriate facilities to maintain the animals in animal facilities. Okay, see, facility design should be appropriate manner. It should be well designed in isolated place, and also it will be corner of the institution, and it should have different rooms, animal quarantine room, animal breeding room, animal living room, and animal experimentation room. Four different areas, and the animal house should have sterilization facilities. Why? Because whatever husk we are using, whatever bedding material we are using, whatever food material we are using for feed the animals, all those things having a risk of transmitting pathogenic infection from one place to other places. So all the facilities should be designed appropriate manner to fulfill the minimum national requirement. So facility construction, that also discussed ventilation. Ventilation is very, very important. Many of the places, the recommended one is HEFA filter. Animal house will be equipped with HEFA filter to provide. Nowadays, it will be designed, animal cages are designed such a way that the animal will get purified air. All the cages will be close the cages, linked with the air purifier. Animal will get pure air. That will whatever exhaling air will be get purified before releasing into the environment. Animal housing. So it will be before some years, many places open cages are used for housing the animals. Now no more. Almost 80% of the places now converted into the filter top cages or isolators. Filter top cages, how it will be. This is about 1980s, 90s, and up to 2000, open cages. Animals will be housed in open cages. These open cages having problem with whatever animal is, what excrete, urine or saliva or fecal matter, or the content will be get evaporated and mixed with the environment, minimum ammonia, or it will be amides, biological amides and amino compounds. Those compounds are contain sometimes, those are the animal exudates sometimes pathogens. That pathogens, those are entering in animal house, they are having high chance of getting infected. So nowadays, last 10 years, last few decades, the recommended one is filter top cages. Animal will be housing filter top cages. So that whatever things, it won't come out. So later, every day, they can go for recycling the animal from one cage to other cage, so that we can prevent spreading of infection. If in case the study is involving with tuberculosis, or it will be any other viruses, or it will be pathogenic bacteria, those times isolators can be used. This is isolator. So animal can be handled through the area provided over there. Animal will be housed inside, so we can prevent spreading of the disease. This is typical arrangement of animal house. So animals will be housed in filter top cages. The person who is working in animal house having all the PPEs, long lab coat, gloves, mask, head cap, and also possibly goggles also for to protect eyes, should be used to prevent the pathogenic transmission. And also animal transport also very, very important. When transporting animal from one facility to other facilities, all the things should be documented properly, and the animal should be housed properly in closed cages. Closed cages. If open cages having high risk of transmitting pathogenic infection from animal to outside environment. Inventory monitoring and control. All the time, animals should be monitored at least once in a day. Okay. So biosafety equipment, at least recommended one is biosafety level 2, animal biosafety level 2. See, this is not animal room, this is not animal living room, animal experimentation room. Animals are housed in the filter top cages. So animals now not having any chance to spread disease from animals to other environment. So animals will be taken from the filter top cages to biosafety cabinet, animal biosafety cabinet level 2. So here also there will be protection layer. Half of the layer will be closed with the glass. So the person is having all the PPEs, shoe cover, long apron, it will be goggles, everything. So animals will be placed inside. See, cages here, So animal person is working with animals. When coming to the, if in case the accident having the chances of high chances of risk, those times the person can animal accident can be done under the animal biosafety level 3. Yeah. So that time additionally person should have air purifier, and it will be additional care to prevent transmitted disease from animal to host, animal to human being. So this how the human person is working in ABSL level 2, how the person is working with ABSL level 3 having additional protection. So we are not inhaling any air in animal facilities. When we are entering animal house itself, we are carrying the purifier. So whatever air we are inhaling, that will be purified air, not having any pathogenic we are not inhaling any pathogens. Okay. So this way we can arrange our animal experimentation. Okay. So personal protective equipment, this also very important. Okay. So at least minimum requirement, shoe cover, hand gloves, gargles, cap, okay, air purifier, minimum things. Okay. So then here it will be. So this is about the primary, this one is primary barrier. So primary barrier, what we are wearing, personal protective equipment. Secondary barrier, the animal should be designed such a way that with very good ventilation facilities and adequate air purifying facilities and also with other protective equipment, sink and hand wash, specific special contaminant areas, special air ventilation premises, sterile equipments, these are the secondary barriers. Always PPEs, primary barriers and secondary barriers. The animal experimental laboratory should be equipped with both primary barrier and secondary barrier to prevent pathogenic transmission from animal to human beings. Okay. And also those who are working with animals, they should be given appropriate training and education to prevent spreading of disease from animal to human being, and also protect themselves from animal bite and also inhaling contaminant from the animals. Okay. So then decontamination and waste management is very, very important. Why? Because many places we are lacked with waste management. Why? Because in academic institution, we are using less than around 1% of the animals. But throughout the globe, around 80 million of the animals used for the drug research purposes, drug test purposes. All those animals, how we are managing at the end of the experimentation. So far, we are not having adequate data on euthanized animals. How we euthanized, what will happen after euthanized? How we decontaminated the dead animals? We are not having appropriate data. Okay. So same like all the labs should have emergency plan. Okay. At least because sometimes the researchers, they will work alone in the animal house facilities. So that time accidentally or intentionally, they may have chance to get laboratory urgencies, or it will be chance of getting acute infections. So that time such a thing happens, what will be the emergency plan? What should they should be done? All those things appropriate education should be given to researchers. And biosecurity, we have to protect ourselves as well as animal species. This is very, very important, biosecurity. Why? Because now many of the animals, genetically modified animal we are using. Because we have to remember one thing, that the earth is not only for us, all other living matters. It starts from small ant, starts from small one cell animal, amoeba from large animal, human beings. So the earth is having equal probability to give life to all the species. So that biosecurity is very important. So that the ecosphere we have to respect. So this way we can manage the risk of spreading disease from animal to human beings. Okay. So what kind of biohazards in the animal facilities? Biohazards, it will be come from many, many, many sources, which include disease models. Okay. So the majority of major modern diseases such as Ebola virus and Salmonella disease are from zoonosis. Because we are thinking that we are doing experimentation in the animals,
But thing when you're doing the experimentation, there are many chances to get animal cells get mutated or whatever pathogen we are inserting into the animal, they are having a high chance of go for the mutation. That mutant will come out that may kill the entire globe. Okay, so now the typical diseases, the Ebola virus disease and salmonellosis are from zoonoses, from animals, and also adding into that HIV. HIV also from animals, because wrongly, the human will be associated with the monkeys in some particular region of the world. So from them, the disease was spreaded. Disease was spreaded to entire world, okay. The contaminant cell line and other biological matters, that also will spread the disease. And the experimental infection, infectious agent and biological toxins from the laboratory will spread the diseases. Okay. So the consequences of accidental exposure of personnel to biological hazard can be quite severe, including clinical diseases, hospitalization, even that may cause death. Okay, so sometimes you may think that that will be accidentally happening. Animal is biting accidentally. If animal bites, immediately the researchers or animal laboratory workers, they have to visit hospital and find out that they are not having any further problems and try to get treated immediately. Why? Because we are having known incident. So from animals, Ebola virus disease, salmonellosis, and HIV from the animals. So that when they are having any chance of accidental exposure, the investigator or student or researchers or laboratory workers or technicians over there, they have to go for the medical checkup and try to, because symptomatic we know, asymptomatic we may not. From asymptomatic infections, that will be, we become carrier. When we go to the society, we will spread the diseases. Okay. So these accidental exposure may cause severe to mild to severe infections or asymptomatic conditions or clinical diseases, or sometimes force us to go for hospitalization. Sometimes it will cause death also. So we have to be careful with animal facilities. Okay, how to prevent? There are some preventive measures suggested by the various authors. One is we have to follow the guidelines. We have to follow the guidelines. Whatever may be, we have to follow the guidelines. These guidelines are to be programs made by various government agencies and they draft guidelines, and the draft guidelines are circulated to the many scientists, and finally they're finalizing and releasing to the general public as well as researchers. One of the familiar known publisher, NIH, National Institute of Health, they published Biosafety in Microbial and Biomedical Laboratories. This manual giving entire things about infection controls and guide for the care and use of laboratory animals, have given entire information about what are the possible diseases from animal to human being, how to prevent, how to maintain the animal house, how to dispose the if any animal is having the diseases. All those information given in these two manuals, the researchers, they can go through these manuals to acquire more knowledge about infection controls. Okay. This information mainly help us to prevent risk of self-contamination. Okay. And equipment and facilities. Always we try to do work under animal biosafety level two, under the biosafety. That is actually nothing, biosafety cabinet. Okay, that is primary barrier. Biosafety cabinet, secondary barrier. PPEs are primary barriers. With PPEs and the biosafety cabinet, and it will be, we can have biosafety professional in the institution to consult and ensure the correct type of biosafety cabinet what we are using for the animal species. Okay, always you should consult with biosafety professionals. To prevent microbial contamination from animal to human beings. And also we have to monitor animal house and animal movements in the institution, and animal facilities should be inspected at regular intervals to prevent contamination. And always suggested only PPEs, personal protective equipment, that is must. Students or researchers or animal house workers or it will be technicians, those who are entering in animal lab or animal house or animal facilities, they must always be with PPEs. Okay. And also when doing procedures, there are high chances of getting, because when doing some procedures, always we are using the knife or surgical sutures or needles or scissors. So that time the researchers having high chances of getting injury. So that time when the researcher getting injured, what can be done? Okay, because all the procedures we are not doing with healthy animals. Sometimes we are doing procedure on infected animals. So that we have to be careful on that. Same like waste disposal. this is very, very important. Why? Because some of the studies like antidiarrheal, antiviral studies, antibacterial studies in vivo antibacterial studies, those studies are done with animals. Those animals will be administered with a known pathogen. Okay, end of the studies, what we are going to do with infected animals, that is very, very important. Okay, infected animals, you cannot have to live as we like. They have to be sacrificed ethically as per the guidelines and disposed properly. Either disposal procedure, we have to deep burial or incinerate. Either way, we can dispose the animals. Okay. Same like once experimentation done, sanitation process. Animals should be sanitized at frequent intervals. Same like the recommended is animal house should have shift room. Because 1 month animals are placed in one particular room. Next month, those animals should be shifted to second room, and that existing animal room should be fumigated. So that should be done to prevent unnecessarily culture growth. Animal handling and resistant animal handling is very important. And why? Because many times the researchers, without having the PPEs, they will handle the animals. First time, what will happen? They are having high chance of getting, because normally if you see the animal skin will have some kind of mites, or it will be some mites will be there. It will be, we can see our naked eyes. So those mites will handle the animal without having PPEs, without having the gloves, without having mask. So after handling animal, directly will take our hands to the face, and we will wipe the face, and we will scrub our nose, and sometimes we'll touch our mouth. So after handling this animal, directly we're taking and touching our entire body, so that we are having high chances of getting that mice into the system. That mites may be go inside our body and proliferate, and that mites may cause induce severe pathological condition to the host. So that always be careful with handling the animals. And always institutes should have guidelines. We may have national guidelines and international guidelines, but national and international guidelines, it will be universal guidelines, but institute will have one particular specific animal species only, not all. So that all the institutes should have the local guidelines, and investigators are given brief briefing with institutional guidelines to prevent unnecessary pain to the animal, as well as unnecessary acquisition of the laboratory accident. Okay, researchers, those involving with hazards are required to consider institute animal ethical guidelines. Who is responsible? Ultimately, the responsibility of review of proposal as well as approval of the proposal will fall into the animal ethical committees. Okay, so ultimate responsibility will go to the institutional animal ethical committee, because they are only reviewing the proposal and they are only approving the proposals. If any biohazard will come from the animals or any pandemic will come from the animals, institute is responsible. And also second, institutional biosafety committee is playing major role. This committee is reviewing the use of hazard agent in animals. So both Institute Animal Ethical Committee, Institutional Biosafety Committee having the major role to prevent environmental contamination. Okay, these are the various ways we can reduce the risk and manage the risk. Okay, so now we'll see a little bit about animal biosecurity. This is actually many places now we are talking about biosecurity. What is biosecurity? This is very, very important area. Okay, we can do n number of studies. We can go for n number of developing disease models. Why? Because initially we used to do study with rodent, or it will be primates, or it will be non-human animals. We'll take the animals, we'll induce the disease to the animals. But the recent technologies, last 20 years, they are having knockout animals. These were genetically modified to have congenital disease. Now it will be rat or mice, or it will be hamster will come with diabetes. Whatever disease you want, we'll make congenital. So like that, when you're modifying, when you are modifying animals, that may give a lot of problem to the entire ecosphere. Okay. So the animal biosecurity is implementation of measure to prevent diseases introduction into the healthy population of animals. Because many of the studies, we are inducing disease to the animals. If you want to check anti-Parkinsonian effect of the drug, we'll induce Parkinson to the animal. If you want to check anti-diabetic potential of any compound, we'll induce diabetes to the animals. If you want to check anti-hypertensive effect of the drug, we'll induce hypertension to the animals. So this is security for that animal, questionable. So this biosecurity is providing a measure to prevent disease introduction into the healthy population of animal, or limit the spread of disease once introduced. Okay, there is no other goal. We want to test drug for its anti-diabetic activity or anti-Parkinsonian effect or anti-hypertensive effect. There is no other goal. We have to check it before take the drug into the clinical trials. But we have to check then how we can limit this spread of disease once introduced. Once you are introducing diabetic, the diabetic animal should not be taken for the breeding. Once you introduced hypertension to the animal, once experimentation over, that animal should be isolated, can be maintained throughout its life, but that animal should not be allowed for go for the breeding. Once, because already we introduced disease, something physiologically changed inside the animal body. So those animals, we are forced them to go for the breed to have more number of pups. Automatically, the subsequent generation of animal will have disease. So we have to be careful. So this biosecurity is a very important area. So this is actually providing measure to prevent disease introduction into healthy population of animal, or limit the spread of disease once introduced. Okay, from I4 is a company. Okay, he says actually, we hold a unique responsibility for ensuring biosecurity and animal health. Who is holding? Ultimately, we are holding. So animal may not know what we are doing, but we know that actually. So we are holding the these biosecurity things. So we have to be careful with introducing any disease to the animal. Why? Because these things may be very serious area, because when we can introduce a disease to the animal, but same disease sometime we will get back. Okay, what are different levels of biosecurity? Conceptual biosecurity, structural biosecurity, procedural biosecurity. These are three different types of biosecurities. One is conceptual biosecurity, that is limiting access by personnel not directly involved in the operation or controlling the spread of disease. They are limiting the personnel involving with operation and controlling the spread of diseases. Second one is structural biosafety. This is actually physical factor, like it will be facilities. Procedural biosecurity, this is actually treasury level, mainly prevent bio-exclusion or bio-contamination. This is actually to prevent bio-exclusion or bio-contamination. This way, these are three different levels of biosecurity to prevent and protect animal species from bio-contamination. Okay, so far we've seen about why you are using animals, what are different possible types of strains animal used to carry, what are different biocontaminants animal may have, how to prevent, how to control it. Okay, this everything we've seen. Now, what will happen to animals after testing? This is actually one of the major question. Why? Because the statistics says we are using almost 80 million of animals for the research. But these 80 million of animals, what we are doing? Either euthanizing or rehabilitating. Yes, euthanizing and rehabilitating. But recent bill amended by the U.S. Parliament stating that the animal after the experimentation can be adopted. But this is actually one of the major concerned area, because the laboratory animals are is not like routine animal or normal animals, because these animals are bred specifically for some particular purposes. Those animals cannot be housed in the with our living environment. After the testing, these animals cannot be lived in the wild, because these animals cannot able to adapt wild environmental conditions. Okay, and also the tested animal cannot able to cope up with the home environment. So that the recent US bill stating that the laboratory animals can be adopted, but it's not possible. Why? Because once we are adopting these animals cannot able to cope up with our regular lifestyles. So that we cannot able to use these animals for adaptation. Okay, now before ending, the scientists are creating new incurable disease in lab. When it was stated in 2014, this was published in the Atlantic magazine. The scientists are creating new incurable disease in lab. Yeah, it is true, because we knowingly or unknowingly, when are using many number of pathogens in the lab, those animals will get infected. Sometimes some of the animal will escape from the lab and go to the normal living environment. From the normal living environment, it will spread the disease to the other people. So that we have to be careful with working with animals, and we'll try to minimize the number of animals used for the, any of the researchers, and also try to protect ourselves first, because doing experiment is secondary, but protecting ourselves is very, very essential, because most of the youngsters, they are having curious or first time experimentation, directly go and involve unknowingly with the animal activities, finally encountered with some of the problems. So that those are working animals, first thing is always our prime objective is protect ourselves and maintain the animal colonies, because we have to protect ourselves as well as we have to maintain this entire ecosphere, because one common thing is all the living matter in this earth having equal probability on this earth. The earth is not only made for human being, the earth is made for all the living matters. We have to give path to other animals also, because when those living, we can live happily, because it will be systematic exchange between one species to other species. Okay, so we'll give respect to the animal, and we'll protect ourselves by wearing the personal PPEs, and we'll try to have all the animal experimentation under at least ABSL level 2, animal biosafety level 2. Okay, that way we can maintain and control the spread of disease from animal to the external environment. With this, I'll hand over my talk to the chairman. Before ending this section, I would like to thank AIIMS management and organizer, especially Dr. Subhash Bore, to making this avenue to share my ideas to the other participant. Thank you, chairman, and thank you, management, and thank you, moderators. With this, I'll hand over mic to the chairman. Thank you. So there are some few questions. Moderator,
thank you so much, Dr. Parshuraman. Thank you so much. Am I audible, please? Am
I? Yes, we can hear Dr. Richa.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Parshuraman, for a very elaborate talk. It covered lots of areas. I have one or two questions on the chat box. In fact, only one at the moment, and it is from Vidovati, and we want to ask that why animals are living in lab animal lab. Am I clear?
Yeah, we can hear Dr. Richa.
Okay. That were living in lab, but so weakly comparing with the animals that were living freely outside. I think basically she wants to say that why are the animals which are outside or in forest which live longer than the animals which we are keeping in the lab? So Dr. Parshuraman, could you please elaborate on that? It's a very general question.
Voice is audio is not clear, but just why the animals
I'll repeat it. Why the animals living in the why the animals living with outside the laboratory, they live longer than the animals which live inside the laboratory, which die easily.
Yeah, the animals in the environment, their own environment, the animals in their own environment having the liberty and they are having stress free. Why? Because the animal which you are using in the laboratory goes for a lot of stress because you are restraining the animal in the particular small areas and we are animal housing the animal in small cages and the animal not having normal environmental breathing. So always we are giving, it will be purified air, it will be hygienic food. Animal may not having the adequate immunity to fight with the external environment, other pathogens, and easily try to acquire other diseases. So these laboratory animals normally used to have, the lifespan is very lesser than the animal which lives in an external environment because external animal those lives in the wild having the probability of they can travel many distance and they can eat what they like. So those kind of things, it will make animal to live longer. But the laboratory animals, it will be standard food, standard water, it will be ration type. Morning 10 ml water, it will be 2 gram food. That's it. If angry also cannot able to eat, it will be sometime animal will go for the lot of stress. So those stress will make the animals to live with a lesser lifespan.
Yes, I agree. Yes, it is basically the management. I will just elaborate a little bit on more on that. It is basically the management of the animal house that makes the animal live long or less for a lesser duration. Generally, as per the ethics guidelines, we have to have rehabilitation, refinement, and the three basic R's that are required for the animal house, in which the animals are not supposed to die because you're supposed to keep them in most hygienic conditions, giving them the best food. So it is the management which will help extend the life of the animal. And basically, when you if it is for mice and all, you have to have play toys in that, and for rabbits also you have to have pens for that. So if you give them a good environment, they will definitely live longer and much longer. In most of the laboratories, they have lived longer and they will not catch hold of any infection. So I hope we are able to satisfy you. Anybody else, if they have any question? I'm surprised that there are no questions. Has everybody understood everything about everything what Dr. Parasuraman said? Is it like that? Is it? There is one question from Dr. Prabha. He says, the journal reviewers ask for test results from more animals, that is statistical purposes, but the ethics committee approves only limited animals. How do you resolve that issue? Dr. Parasuraman, will you be?
Dr. Parasuraman, your mic is muted.
Yeah. Sorry, sir. Because it will be even in 1980s, some of the journals published, N equal to 5, because N is purely depending upon the investigator. Because many times, if you start approving, if you start using 30 animal per group or 8 animal per group, we are unnecessarily killing the animals. For example, before 20 years, we used one particular frog species for the academic purposes. One particular point, we are not at all finding that particular frog in entire environment. So indicating that we can use the animals for the experimentation purposes, but there is some limitation. Because sometimes we are doing the experimentation on 6 animal or 60 animal, the result will be similar only. Because all the times we cannot able to make use of 60 animal for the experimentation and also the maintenance, and we are killing the animals unnecessarily for our own benefits. Some of the agencies, especially WHO, stating that by 2035, we have to stop all the animal experimentation to preserve the animal species. So that last 10 years, we have started practicing to minimize the number of number of animal usage in experimentation, and also we try to minimize suffering of other animals for human benefits. We want to know whether drug is having effect or not. We want to know whether drug is producing toxicity or not. For that basic information, we need minimum number of animals. Moreover, the recent research on HIV, many of the vaccine shows activity in rodents, especially in mice and rat. When coming to the clinical trials, not at all showing any activity, because almost 6 or 7 clinical trials showed effectiveness of drugs against HIV virus in animals. When coming to the clinical things, it will be not at all responding. So that the animal data is very preliminary to understand the basic pattern of pharmacokinetic and dynamic and toxicology profile, but for that purpose, we cannot able to kill many number of animals. So if we understand basic phenomena, we can extrapolate by using available data, by using suitable statistical methods. We can extrapolate the data by using suitable statistical tools. For that, we are having many mathematical models. So we can, using basic data, we can go for mathematical modeling to make sure that whatever result we are getting from animals are free from errors. So always recommend that minimum number of animals. If at all, increase the power of the studies, we can go for the statistical mathematical models. But one more thing, by 2035, WHO is recommending stop all the experiment, stop using animals for the experimentation purposes, because animals also having their own life.
Yeah, the ethical issues involved in the whole procedure are very, very important for every country. And every country, like in India, we also have very strict rules as to how many animals to be used and whatever is statistically significant. Like, for example, we don't use more than 6 animals per group for a particular drug trial or even for a particular infection experiment that we do. And within that group, we can have very terrible results, which will help us in analysis and also produce information which is sufficient and good enough, which for larger number of animals, if you want to go in for, there are population studies. And for that population study, you have to go in for approvals from a different kind of organization. We also have a different organization for which we have large number of animal studies. For example, trials in our institute, we started with influenza vaccine. When we started, we did it with a very few number of birds which were kept in isolators, and we challenged them with influenza. When the vaccine was found successful, we went into population studies. And when population study, initial experiment has to be initially done with smaller number to find good success in that, then you go in for larger number of animals. So I hope you're able to satisfy your query, Dr. Prabha. Anybody else? And there seems there are no questions. And I'm happy everybody enjoyed your presentation. Could you elaborate a little more on Dr. Prasad? Could you elaborate a little more on your on the point of personal protective equipment for the audience? Like, for example, what all are the kinds of personal PPE that we use for protecting ourselves from the infection from the animals? That is one thing. Also, protecting ourselves from the infection which we give to the animals. It is both ways. It is not just the infection which the animals already harbor and transmit to us. We also need to talk about the infection studies that we do. For example, you mentioned Hanta, you mentioned Ebola. The studies that we do on by infecting the mice and the animals. What kind of PPE is available? What kind of PPE is there in your country which is made available for the researchers to look into? The options available.
Yeah, madam. In Malaysia, in veterinary institution, they are having BSL animal BSL level 1 labs. So those kind of studies they are doing in the animal biosafety level 1. So normally other institution not recommended to do the infective pathogenic research on infective pathogens. If you at all want to use infective pathogens, the study should be carried out under animal biosafety level 1. That the institute was located in Ipoh, controlled by the federal government. It cannot be anywhere actually.
Yeah, Yes. It requires, maybe not for basic laboratories, I agree, not for basic laboratories. We don't do infection studies, and we do the drug trials, maximum or drug studies. But in case of, I think there must be many viewers in this audience who would like to know as to what are the basic requirements for a PPE. Like, for example, it should be, I would elaborate a little more on that. That the basic requirements for PPE should be that it should be lightweight and giving maximum comfort to the wearer, and it should protect against the adequate hazard that we have, and it should, when we select it, we have to go in for the nature of work. For example, in case of BSL-1 agents or for minor drug trials or anything, we don't need to have a very elaborate PPE except for a lab coat. But when it comes to dealing with infectious diseases or the diseases which can come to human beings from the animals, then a detailed study of PPE and detailed requirement of PPE is very important, because you would know that if you work with animals, there are amount of splashes, the animals bite, they scratch, so you have to be very careful as to not having apron or a gown might not be just enough. You need to have a face shield and a mask and a goggle. And when it comes to very high risk pathogens, like infectious diseases, which have bigger implications on human health, then we need to have larger than this kind of protective equipment. Like, we need to have a positive air pressure suits. So that needs to be seen in wherever there are more infectious diseases being handled. And always there are certain do's and don'ts of use. That is, you need to work from clean to dirty. You don't start with the dirtiest work. You start with the clean work first, and then go ahead towards more dirty work. And we don't touch our faces or adjust PPE during the handling of any of the experimental procedures. And if the gloves or anything gets soiled, we need to have double gloves in which we remove the first top glove and then work on procedural glove with the next set of gloves. There's no more other question. So that is enough, I think, about PPE. And is there any kind of emergency response that I would like in your country, where anybody would like to elaborate a little more on that? What kind of emergency responses in case of any accidental exposure? What do we need to do? What are the things that we need to?
Question is clear, madam. But question is very clear, madam, because you are asking about how to manage emergency situations. Huh?
Very little this on
emergency. Institute level, you are reporting to the biosafety committee. But uh-huh. National level, biosafety committee will take up. For institution level, okay. Anything goes wrong, mm-hmm. we'll inform the biosafety committees. Biosafety uh-huh. committee lies with the national institution. So they will talk with the national institution and they will come back with remedies. But as of now, uh-huh. institution level, we used to report to Dr. Subhash. He is chairman for the biosafety.
Yes, I do understand that part. And how do you go about, for example, there's a student who's working and he comes in the room and he sees that suddenly a rat is out and it's out of the cage. How do you go about actually catching it?
Immediately they'll come.
I have had experiences with that. That's why I'm saying it.
Because anything like that, immediately. Usually we are recommending, madam, we are not allowing any single student to go to the animals alone. First thing is, you are not allowing. Because if at all they want to go, they have to go with one accompanying person.
Yes, because two-man rule. Perfect.
Because we are not never encourage our students go as a single person to the animal house. Because animal house is one part of the institution that will be very isolated area. Anything emergencies comes, we may not aware that what they are doing over there. So that always we are recommending when they are going to animal house, two man rule also, they have to inform to the respective supervisor and they have to go. Once they are leaving the animal house, they have to inform to the supervisor that we are leaving the animal house.
Yeah.
So that way we are having man-to-man communication. So that usually students try to, because usually what we are saying is mice, we do have that problem. Mice will come out from the cage easily. But thing is, we are trying to have it will be cages with small, above that we used to have small mesh over there. So some of the incident we observed, we used to keep above the lid cover. Now we are start processing the process of buying closed cover cages, because so far we used
to that's right. No, they escape not cages. From the cage. Sometimes they escape during the handling procedure.
Handling process. Yeah.
Catch the mice at that time. There's a very simple trick that we have identified when we work with our mice, is that sometimes if there's some kind of movement of the mice, you have to keep a cage, a box, a cardboard box maybe, which is open only from one side and should face. The mice will tend to go into the box very easily. So, and then that is how you actually restrain the mice. So it's just a little, small little this for our audience.
But now we start purchasing closed cages, madam. Because so far
we have a closed cage.
Closed cages.
Sometimes during handling the mice. Just escape out of the hand or something.
We'll adopt this method, madam. We used to keep on big
You can try it and see that it works or not.
It will work, madam, because it will be. Thanks, madam. Thanks for a nice suggestion.
And if there's any spillage, precautions that must be taken, for example, if you're handling some not just drug, maybe some infectious material. I understand that now, that in your infectious materials, but then there are places where infectious material is being handled. So if there's any kind of a spillage, or if there's any kind of for emergency response, we need to follow a particular protocol. I would just elaborate a little bit on that you have to leave the premises immediately. That is what we do. That is what should be done in case of any spillage in the room because of the aerosol that is generated. It is very important that the aerosol be limited exposure to the aerosol. So you should not allow anybody to enter that room during that period. And take a note of do not enter. And then we have a spill kit, which should be ready for every lab or wherever infectious work is going on, which will basically have nothing too much, not too much, but it should have a cloth which with a disinfectant, which is to be soaked in with that disinfectant, which could be a 5% hypo or whatever, and spill the area with your cloth. So just keep it on that and let it soak on it. And the whole area that is wherever there is spillage is covered clearly, and then allow appropriate contact time. And then you collect that cloth. It should be collected outside there should be outside in carefully without coming in direct contact, and after putting on gloves and all, and then we have to report to the lab supervisor. There was an interesting study as to how what would you call as safe workers and how would you say unsafe workers. I would like to share with everybody here that generally the safe workers, it is a study done in US, they say that they stick and they know and they adhere to all the safety regulations. Whereas unsafe workers, they generally have a low opinion of safety programs. They say, yes, it is not required, or I already know about it. And the safe workers generally are defensive workers. They have defense. They would see the infection or accident everywhere, whereas the unsafe workers tend to take excessive risk and they work too fast. The hand movement is too fast and they do a lot of things in very little amount of time. And they are also less aware of the agent risks that are involved. Even to puncture, to take out blood from the mice, they would be not very, very careful about it and maybe end up injuring the animal. Whereas the safer are the ones who recognize the potential hazard versus situations. So the study with the most interesting part of the said that young males, that is boys, they are no gender bias here. The young males that between the age of 17 to maybe 25 years of age are the ones who end up being labeled under these safe workers, whereas the women and the older people, employees between 45 to 60, are the ones that are more safe workers. I'm no gender bias here, please. So that also is one of the things that I would like to mention here. I still don't have any questions. I'm surprised. Anybody else would like to ask anything? No.
No questions, madam.
No questions. It's good that there are no questions. It's always nice not to have, not to be in confusion about anything. If there's anybody else, I mean, if anything else anybody would like to ask, I would be happy to. Otherwise, we shall, I think we shall, we can always end on indication from Dr. Bhore. If he wants it to end, I will definitely end the session. And Bhore, please, would you, what is your suggestion?
Yeah, yeah. MC can take over, eh? MC, yeah.
Sorry?
Yeah, Kanchana will take over. Yeah.
Kanchana will take.
Yeah.
We'll take questions. Okay.
Thank you very much, Dr. Parasuraman, for the wonderful talk. Thank you, Dr. Richa, for moderating the session so greatly. We had a great program today. On behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to thank all the participants for being a part of the program of Biosafety and Biosecurity Month, October 2020 at Ames University. Before ending the session, we would like to hear feedback from all the participants by scanning the QR code that's shown in the screen right now. You can either scan the QR code or go to the link given. The link will also be provided in the chat box in a short while. We assure you that it won't take more than 1 minute to complete the evaluation survey. Upon completion of the evaluation survey, you will receive the participation certificate. Just take note that it might take some time for you to receive the certificate through email. I'll keep the screen running for 2 more minutes in order for everyone to scan both the QR codes. Stay safe and stay healthy. We are hoping to see all of you in our next session. Thank you. I hope everyone has scanned the QR code by now. I'm going to end the meeting. Thank you very much for joining us today. Stay safe and have a wonderful day ahead.